بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدي وحبيبي ونور قلبي وثمر فؤادي أبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين ذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم صلى الله عليك يا أبا عبد الله صلى الله عليك يا ابن رسول الله عليك وعلى أهل بيتك الملائكة يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله السلام عليك وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى
Every year when Muharram comes, that is when a lot of questions started to pop up. A lot of people, they have questions. A lot of people, they have suspicions. And I just want to remind myself and remind all of us that most of the time, we mostly think about people who steal your money. They steal your identity. But we don't think about people who try to steal your aqidah, your faith, your iman. And when you go to the Quran, because of the importance of your aqidah, your faith, your belief, our Imam, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
When they ask him, ma ma'na qawlullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, falyanzuru al-insanu ila ta'amin. When they ask him, what is the meaning of this ayah, which the literally meaning of it is, let every soul look at the food they eat. Imam responded, he says, no, it's not the food that you and I normally eat. Imam says, فَلْيَنْظُرُ الْإِنسَانُ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِهِ أَيْ فَلْيَنْظُرُ الْإِنسَانَ إِلَىٰ عِلْمِهِ مِمَّنْ يَأْخُرُ. Be careful about the knowledge that you take. So that is one of the things we have to remember. There are in Muharram, there are people who come. Some of them, they come with questions, they want to know. That is fine. And there are some people in Muharram is the time they want to steal your aqidah. They want to put some suspicious in your aqidah and your mind. Right? Now I'll give you some examples. One example, in Muharram, you hear a lot of people, they ask questions. They said there are some narrations that on the night of the 8th of Muharram or 7th of Muharram, Imam Hussein alayhi salam did karama. Right? Karama means Imam Hussein used his finger and he dabbed the hole and the water came out. That's mentioned in narration. In history is mentioned. The first thing some people will ask, how could that be possible? How can Hussein make this miracle? Doesn't add up in their mind. Some people will ask and say, no. There is a narration they said that when the Imam Hussein was killed, when his head was on the spear, Imam Hussein was reading Surah Al-Kahf. أَفْحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ كَانُوا مِنْ آيَاتِنَا عَجَبًا. It's mentioned in the history that Imam Hussein did read Quran after he died. You see, some people come and ask, they say, how can this be possible? A person who got killed, he is just the head reading Quran, how could that be possible? Right? That's number two. Number three, some people come, they said that on the day Imam Hussein was killed, the entire world witnessed blood. Right? You take a stone, there is a blood underneath. And some people, they will go one step forward to say, Rasulullah is better or Hussein. So Hussein is not to the Prophet level. Then they said, if the Prophet passed away and this didn't happen, how would this happen to Hussein alayhi salam? That's how they compare. That is, how could that be possible? Right? And so many examples. Another one, they said, how could the Imam write Ziyarat Ashoura and say this kind of la'an in them? Right? We read in the Ziyarat Ashoura that there's a la'an. They say, how could that be? They say, that doesn't sound like Imam. Because Imam would know him Rahim and he is so forgiven. He would not come in the Quran and say such. And the Ziyarat Ashoura to say such la'an. For example, Allahumma la'an. Right? Abu Sufyan. Allahumma al'an al Marwan wa al Ziyad. Right? Allahumma al'an al-asabata allati jahadat al-Husayn wa shaya'at wa taba'at wa ba'i'at ala qadr. Allahumma al'anhum jami'a. That is impossible. That is not Imam who will say such thing. That is one of the things. But I don't want to answer all these questions that I just presented just for you, just to think about it. But in this gathering, I just want to talk about la'an. That the Ziyarat Ashura that we read, is it true that it came from Ma'asum and that Ma'asum could say such thing in Ziyarat Ashura, or it's not from Imam? That is one. And number two, did Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, did he say la'an or not in the Quran? And that is what I just want to focus on this speech, just to emphasize that when we compare Ziyarat Ashura and the Holy Quran, is there any la'an in the Quran or there is none? Right? That is what we have to compare to see. If there is a la'an in the Quran, then Allah is the first one to do la'an. If there is not, then where did the Ziyarat Ashura came from? The la'an. Now, when we go to the Quran, there is so many la'an in the Quran. And I'm gonna give you references to understand that the first one to say la'an is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first one before any human being to say a la'an is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the first ayah is Surah An-Nisa, where Allah is talking about Iblis. إِنْ يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا إِنَاثًا وَإِنْ يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا شَيْطَانًا مَرِيدًا لَعَنَهُ اللَّهُ وَقَالْ لَأَتَّخِذَنَّ مِنْ عِبَادِكَ نُصِيبًا مَفْرُورًا. The first one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself, he said, لَعَنَهُ اللَّهُ. Allah said, Shaitan, Iblis, when he was set out of the heaven because of the misguidance, misleading that he did to Adam alayhi salam and Hawa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him in one of the ayah, مَا مَنَعَكْ يَا إِبْلِيس, مَا مَنَعَكْ, what prevented you, what stopped you? And this judah is the amartuk, when Allah asked you to do sajda, right? He says, خَلَقْتَنِي مِن نَار وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِن طِين. His answer, Allah, I'm superior over Adam. And here, you know, why did Iblis thought he's superior upon Adam? Why? Adam was the first person to create, right? How did he think that he's better than Adam? Here in Tafsir, they said, before Adam alayhi salam, our father, there used to be another Adam before this Adam, which Iblis used to be their leader. So he used to be a leader of human being. The people of that time, they used to worship, they used to serve Iblis. So now to ask him to do sajda for another human being who they used to be serving him, you think that is what? That is putting him down. That's what Quran says in another ayah, Aba wastakbar. He refused because he thought he's more superior than Adam alayhi salam. That is one. So when he did that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, La'anahu Allah. Allah said, I cursed him. Oh, Shaitan. And here when I say the word La'an, I want to make sure that we understood what is the meaning of La'an. Because sometimes the word La'an in English, it means curse. And curse means bad language. Alright? Sometimes you see the youth and they say, you know, what would Islam say to curse, to say bad language? No. There's a difference between foul language and the la'an which we're talking about. The foul language is haram in Islam. We are not allowed to use even foul language with the people who are not believing believers. لَا تَصُبُّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَيَصُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرَ عَلْمٍ. Allah said, don't even use the bad language with the kuffar. But so that is not halal, that's haram in Islam. But we're talking about curse here, which means Allah means to ask Allah to deprive his rahmah from someone. Allah'an ay taradu rahmah al-ilahi min shakhs. When I say la'natullah ala shaytan, meaning I'm asking Allah not to let shaytan to see Allah's rahmah. That's what it means. So in Ziyarat Ashoura, what Imam is asking is, Ya Allah, don't let those people to see Rahmah of Allah, the mercy of Allah. That's it. So when we say about the curse, that's what we mean. Not the foul language. A'udhu Billah. Now, so the first one to curse in the Quran is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is number one. Number two, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also cursed. This is Iblis, jinn, right? Now come to people. There are certain people Allah also cursed them. Where? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كَيْفَ يَهْدِ اللَّهُ قَوْمًا كَفَرُوا بَعْدَ إِيمَانِهِمْ وَشَهِدُوا أَنَّ الرَّسُولَ حَقٌّ. Right? إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِ الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala جَزَاهُمْ أَنَّ عَلَيْهِمْ لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ وَالْمَلَائِكَ وَالنَّاسَ أَجْمَعِينَ. Allahu Akbar. Allah says, some people, Allah said, we curse them, and the entire angels, they curse them too, and so as the entire human being. Who are they? Allah said, people who saw the truth. شَهِدُوا الْحَقِّ. They saw the truth, right? آمَنُوا, they believed in Allah. ثُمَّ كَفَرُوا. Then they turned back, right? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَشَهِدُوا أَنَّ الرَّسُولَ حَقْ. And they bear witness Rasulullah is the truth. But then they turn back against the Prophet. Right? Here Allah says, those people, their punishment is la'natullah of Allah, the curse of Allah is on them, wa'nas wa'l-malaika. Allah is saying, that is number two. Number three, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curse any person who kills al-mu'min. A mu'min, a person practicing Muslim, I take their life, Allah said, I curse the person. Woman, in Surah An-Nisa, وَمَنْ يَقْتُلْ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمْ وَغَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَلَعَنَ وَعَدَّ لَهُ عَذَابًا عَلِيمًا. Just killing one mu'min. And from this point I want to tell you that one of the reasons why it's okay to curse the killers of Hussein is from this ayah. Because Allah said, وَمَنْ يَقْتُلُ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا. Whoever kills a mu'min, muta'ammid, willingly. Right? Allah says four things, four punishment. Number one, فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمْ. Allahu Akbar. Allah says there is no question. يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. When the person comes, he kills a mu'min intentionally. Allah says there is no question, they're going to Jahannam. That's one. Number two, وَغَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. Allah says, I'm angry at that person. Number three, وَلَعَنَا, and I cursed the person as well. وَأَعَدَّ لَهُ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا. Allah said, then we prepared the most painful punishment for that person. Why? Because he killed just a mu'min. Now question, Imam Hussein, was he a mu'min or not? Huh? Is there anybody that doubt that he was a mu'min? Yes. Okay, got it. Now, if a person kills Imam Hussein, who happened to be a mu'min, and the Quran says, وَلَعَنَا, can I follow the steps of Allah and curse the person because he killed a mu'min? One. Two, is there anybody among the companions, among the Muslims, who doubt that the companions of Imam Hussein, they were believers? One of them, Abul Fadl Abbas. Is there anybody doubt that he was a mu'min? Is there anybody doubt that the companions of Imam Hussein, Zuhair ibn al-Qayn, Muslim ibn al-Awsajah, Habib ibn al-Mudahir, for example, are they believers or not? We believe they are mu'mineen. And person who killed them intentionally, can we send the la'na of Allah on them or not? If Quran allows it to kill, if Allah was the first one to do la'an on those who killed the mu'min muta'amin. That is why when you hear a la'an, that is one of the ayah that this was driven from. That is number two. Number three. One of the people that Allah cursed in the Quran are the people who hiding the truth. I found the truth, but I'm hiding the truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he's cursing the people. Any kind of truth I came to find, I came across, and I'm hiding it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'm cursing that person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْتُمُونَ مَا أَنزَلْنَا مِنَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا بَيَّنَّاهُ لِلنَّاسِ فِي الْكِتَابِ أُولَٰئِكَ يَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّاعِنُونَ. الله أكبر. And here they come, the ayah came in the form of يَلْعَنْ صِيغَةُ الْمُضَارِ, which means للاستمرار. Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْتُمُونَ, those who took on themselves to hide the truth. مِن بَعْدِ مَا بَيَّنَّاهُ لِلنَّاسِ, after it was clear to people, Allah said, أُولَٰئِكَ يَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّهُ. Allah said, I am cursing those people. وَيَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّهُ. The angels, the other humans, Allah said, they're all cursing them because they hide the truth. That's the la'na in the Quran for those who are hiding the truth. That is number four. Number five, Al-Kadhib, a liar. A person who's telling lies, Quran cursed them too. If a person, a mu'min, or a person who is who knows Allah, would not lie. That's why they asked the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, hal al-mu'min yasrib? Ya Rasulullah, can a mu'min steal? He said, no. Hal al-mu'min yazni? Can mu'min commit fornication? He said, yes. Hal al-mu'min yaktab? Na'am, 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 na'am. Hal al-mu'min yakdhib? Mu'min doesn't lie. Right? Because Al-Kadhim Mal'un fil Kitab Allah. Where? In Surah Al-Imran. Allah tells us, فَمَنْ حَاجَّكَ فِيهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ نَدْعُ أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ فَنَجْعَلْ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ Allah, فَنَجْعَلْ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ الْكَاذِبِ A person who lies, Allah said in the Quran, the person is cursed. Because a lie is one of the worst thing you can do in Islam. And that is why Imam al-Hassan al-Askari alayhi salam, he said that جَمَعَ اللَّهُ كُلُّ الْمَعَاسِي فِي غُرْفَةٍ وَجَعَلَ مِفْتَاحَهُ الْكَذِبِ Imam al-Hassan al-Askari? كُلُّ الْأَشْرِ Every sin that you can think of, he said Allah placed them in a room. And Allah made the locker of that room as well. Lying. Allahu Akbar. And that is why lie is one of the worst things Islam has forbidden. So here Allah says, فَنَجَعَ اللَّعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ A lie is also مَلْعُونَ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ Allah says, that is number five. Number six. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also cursed a certain group of people. Now the one that I gave you is individuals, right? Now I'm going to give you a group because in Ziyarat Ashoura we say Allahumma la'anil isaba. Isaba means group, right? Now in the Quran, Allah not only curses individuals, He also curses group of people. Right? Who are they? Allah said la'annahum kama la'anna ashab as-sabt. Kama la'anna ashab as-sabt. Who are the Ashab al-Sabt? Ashab al-Sabt are the people in the Quran who are called the companions of Saturday. And they were one of the followers of Musa alayhi salam, Bani Israel. Those Bani Israel, their job used to be, they go fishing. They go fishing how many days? 7 days a week. Every day they go fishing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to them, Ashab al-Sabt, at least keep 1 day for Allah. Go 6 days, and 1 day, just do ibadah. Go to your places, your mosque, to do your prayer. Don't go to fish. They said, okay. Now what happened? They thought they are smarter than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? Then what happened? They said, okay. On Saturday we are not going fishing, but what we're going to do, we're gonna set all the nets and the nets in the sea. Alright? On Sun Friday when we leave, Saturday we're not supposed to come. But we're gonna set the nets, right? So that way, by the Sunday we come, all the fish are stuck in there, right? So we gotta catch them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Musa. Musa told them, even that is not allowed. You cannot do that. And look, that how did Allah test them? Before that, before they started putting the net, they started listening to Allah. First, they will go to the sea. On Saturday, they go there just to watch, but they're not catching fish, right? And Allah wanted to test them. So on Saturday that they don't catch the fish, Allahu Akbar, when they go, they see big, big fish. But the next day when they go, those fish are gone. Allahu Akbar, what happened? On Saturday they come, those fish come, mashallah, they're wagging their tails. And I'm like, what? What can we do? So the idea came, now instead of waiting until Sunday, on Friday before we leave, we're going to set all the nets, right? So when the fish come, they get stuck in there. But sorry, we're not going to catch them, because we cannot, because Allah said no. But on Sunday when we came, by the time we come, they're already there. So we took them, alhamdulillah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, no, you cannot do that, Bani Israel. But what happened? They didn't listen. Every Friday they set the net. They come and they take. Allah told the Prophet Musa, tell them they can't do that. They didn't listen. One day they came on Sunday to pick up their fish. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, La'annahum kama la'anna ashab as-sabt. Allah said, we cursed them. How did Allah curse them? Another ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah said, فَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ قِرَدَةً خَاسِئِينَ return all of them. Those people, right? Return all of them to monkeys. And look at the ayah. Kiradatan khase. Al khase meaning what? Even lower than the normal monkeys. When they even lower to the other monkeys compared, right? Allah said, we punish them by turning all of them to monkeys. These are called ashabu as-sabt in the Quran. And the reason is what? Because they were disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They did not kill human being, huh? They did not kill Ibn Rasulullah. All they did was to catch fish. And Allah accursed them and turned them to monkeys. Now what about who killed the grandson of the Prophet? Doesn't he or she deserve this type of curse? If a person just catching fish, going against the teaching of Allah, Allah punished them and turned them to monkeys. What about people who killed the grandson of the Prophet? Right? That is one of the people Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also cursed in the Quran. Right? So another one Allah cursed in the Quran also. There are so many of them that when you go to the Quran, Allah cursed them so many. But up to now, this ayah is enough. Now let me take you to the hadith of the Prophet. Did Rasulullah curse someone or not? Because we have always Quran on the, in the hadith of the Prophet. Right? If the Allah did, the Prophet did, yes. Did any hadith that the Prophet said la'an on someone? Yes. Where? Look in Tariq al-Tabari, Tariq ibn Athir. Right? All these historians. What did they say? They said when the Prophet was sick, and the sick that he died of, the Prophet set up group of armies to go to battle for, to go and fight. Then what happened? They said some of the companions didn't want to go. They came back because they were anticipating that the Prophet is going to die. And they didn't want the Prophet to die when they are not in Medina. Because there's a plan. There's something going on. So we have to make sure that we are around. Now what happened? Rasulullah, and the narration says, وَكَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ يُعَانِي السُّدَى. The Prophet was having a headache. Where the narration says, فَخَرَجَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. The Prophet came out and he said to them, it says, إِمْشُوا خَلْفَ أُسَامَ. Because the leader that the Prophet chose that day was Usama. That young man, the Prophet said he's the leader. They came back, they said, Ya Rasulullah, why should we be following this young man? He's like our grandson. The Prophet says, Hakala amarani Rabbi. That's what Allah wants, so follow him. They said, no. So what happened? They came back again. Then the Prophet came out. And the narration says, فَخَرَجَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ مُعَصَّبُ الرَّأَسِ. He turned, he has his turban on. Not as usual as he normally wrap the turban. Then he says, لَعْنَ اللَّهُ مَنْ تَخَلَّفَ أَنْ جَيْشُ أُسَامَ. Rasulullah, لَعْنَ اللَّهُ. He said, may Allah curse anybody who failed to go and be the follower of Usama. Allah, this is Tariq al-Tabari. Rasulullah, he was doing la'an. This is not the person who killed someone. No, because they went against the teaching of the Prophet. Now, let me ask you, brothers and sisters. Now, those who killed Imam Hussein, didn't they go against the teaching of the Prophet? Didn't the Prophet says, إِنِّي مُخَلِّفٌ فِيكُمُ الثَّقَلَيْنِ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَعِتْرَةِ أَهْلَ بَيْتِي فَانْظُرُوا كَيْفَ تُخَلِّفُونِي فِيهِمَا. The Prophet says, I'm leaving two things behind. One is the Quran and the other one is Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam. Take good care of them. Now if somebody comes and kills the Prophet's son, doesn't he deserve the la'an from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Now when we la'an, when we said la'an Allah fulan, may Allah curse these people because they went against the saying of the Prophet as the Prophet did la'an on those people who also go against, went against the saying of the Prophet before the Prophet died. That is the saying of the Prophet. Now, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, did he said curse too? Yes, he did. On the day of Ashura. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he himself, on the day of Ashura, he said the words of la'an on those enemies. After he did everything possible to stop them from that tragedy. What happened? when they were attacking Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Imam Hussein alayhi salam made dua. Allahumma farriqhum tafriqa. Allahumma mazziqhum tamziqa. Allahumma la'anhum la'nan wabila. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he said, Ya Allah, farriqhum. Ya Allah, don't let them be united. They united to fight me. Ya Allah, don't let them be united. And Allahu Akbar. You go to the tariq, you go to the history, you know that the dua of Imam Hussein on the day of Ashura, the same day they started fighting each other. The same day, after the dua of Imam Hussein, Allahumma farriqhum, they started fighting each other. After they killed Imam Hussein alayhi salam, they started fighting on how many heads this is gonna get. How much this one do this will not get. And they fighting each other on just the head. That is one. Number two, some of them, they fought each other about the agreement they have with each other. One of them, Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad and Umar ibn Sa'ad. Right? Umar ibn Sa'ad, he was given an assurance by Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad that he is going to be a governor and they will give him money. Now after he killed Imam Hussein alayhi salam, and Imam Hussein also told him, Umar ibn Sa'ad, on the day of Ashura, he said, Ya Umar ibn Sa'ad, you're not going to get what they promised you. They're not going to give it. And he said, okay, how do you know that? Imam Hussein said, I know them. They're not going to fulfill their promise to you. You know what he thought? He thought he was smart. So he rushed to him, to Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. He said, Ya Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, you promised me three things, right? He said, yes. What are they? He said, one, you promised me that you give me some amount of money, right? He said, yes. He said, you promised me I will be the governor of Ray. He said, yes. He said, you promised me I will be the governor of Jarjan. He said, yes. He said, put it in writing. Allahu Akbar. Put it in writing. Sure, sure. Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad took a paper, wrote everything, stamp, get the paper. Good, right? Now he took the paper. Now wait until after Imam Hussein was killed. He came to Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, Umar ibn Sa'ad. He said, Ya Ibn Ziyad, I want the promise that you promised me. Then Ibn Ziyad said to him, where's the paper? Remember we had the agreement? He said, yeah. He said, get the paper. I'll give you what I told promise. He said, okay. He looked in his pocket. There's no paper. What happened? He went home, searched every corner of his house. No paper. He went back to Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. Ibn Ziyad, I can't find the paper. Ibn Ziyad said, I'm sorry. No paper, no promise. Allahu Akbar. These were friends. They were together. They were bodies against Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Dua of Imam Hussein, Allahumma farriqhum. He came back and Ibn Ziyad told him, no. As long as no paper, you're not going to get anything. And he left the castle of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad and his hat on his head and he says, khasirtu dunya wal akhirah. That's the dua of Imam Hussein. Wa farriqhum. So even among themselves, they couldn't sustain themselves. They couldn't keep that unity among themselves. Right? The same thing also. You go to Umar ibn, you go to Shimr ibn Zaljawshan, la'natullah alayh, with also Yazid ibn Muawiyah. Right? They were friends, right? Yazid promised Shimr that gold, silver, jewelries, inshallah, don't worry about it. All you need to do, kill Imam Hussein and come, I'll give it to you. Right? Now he came on the day of Ashura, after killing Imam Hussein, he went to Sham and he was carrying a big bowl and he was saying, Asa imla rikabi faddatan wa dhahaba fa inni qataltu khayran nasi umman wa aba. Allahu Akbar. He said, قَتَلْتُ خَيْرَ النَّاسِ أُمَّنْ وَعَلَى. And you know, Yazid said to him, he said, يَا مَلْعُونَ إِذَا عَلِمْتَ أَنَّهُ خَيْرُ النَّاسِ أَبًا وَأُمَّنْ لِمَا قَتَلْتَ. The good question Yazid was asking him. He said, yo, if you know that he has the best parents, why did you kill him? You know what he said? حُبُّ الْمَالِ حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا. You know what Yazid told him? In English, if you want to translate it, now you idiot, get out of here. That's what Yazid told him. I said, you idiot, you get out of here, you're not getting the money, you're not getting the gold and jewelry, nothing, get out of here. And he left. And the same thing like Umar ibn Sa'ad, he put his hand on the head and says, khasirtu dunya wal akhirah. That's the dua of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. So Imam Hussein alayhi salam, on the day of Ashura, he did make dua on those enemies after he tried everything. That is Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Now you come to Imam Jafar al-Sadiq in Ziyarat Ashura and the Adi Ziyara, even he says, وَلَعْنَ اللَّهُ قَوْمًا قَتَلُوكَ بِالْأَيْدِ وَالْأَلْسُنِ. Then on the Ziyara of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, وَلَعْنَ اللَّهُ قَوْمًا قَتَلُوكَ بِالْأَيْدِ وَالْأَلْسُنِ. They killed Imam Hussein with the hands and the tongue. So Imam Jafar al-Sadiq is the one who wrote Ziyarat Ashura of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, and in that he mentioned different lines. Allahumma al'an al-asabat allati jahadat al-Husayn. Those who came and fought Imam Hussein and killed Imam Hussein and his family, he said, may Allah curse them. And he mentioned some individuals by name. And the reason is because the crime that was committed on Imam Hussein on the day of Ashura, there is no crime like that crime. Allah, from the day Allah created the heaven and up to now, until the day of judgment, there will never be a crime like Imam Hussein's crime. Right? That is why Imam, he says, La yawm ka yawmika ya Aba. La yawm. There's no day you can find. Even, let me tell you, brothers and sisters, even if you find a person, right, who got killed exactly like Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Exactly, his family, his brothers, his companion, his children, everything, right? But there is one thing that is always going to be missing. One thing you cannot compare. And that is, Hussein is a grandson of Rasulullah. That is something you cannot compare. You can find everything together, right? He was killed, he was deprived from water, he lost his family, but you cannot find someone who is the grandson of the Prophet. You cannot find a person to be his mother is Zahra alayhi salam. You cannot find a person to be his father is Amirul Mu'minin salamullah alayhi. That is one different, big different thing that you cannot find. And that is why the tragedy of Imam Hussein is not like anybody else. And you know Imam al-Hujjah, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif, you know when you come to the tragedy of Imam Hussein, you know what he says? He said, لَأَنْدُبَنَّكَ صَبَاحًا وَمَسَاءً. He said, I will give my condolences to you, Hussein, twice a day. We do it once a day, right? In Muharram, we come in the evening and that's it. He said, I will do it twice. And then he said, وَلَأَبْكِيَنَّ عَلَيْكَ. And I will cry for you. Right? But which kind of crying is going to cry? He says, وَلَا أَبْكِيَنَّ عَلَيْكَ بَدَلَ الدُّمُوعِ دَمًا. Imam al-Hujjah, he said, everybody shed tears. He said, I will share a blood tears for you, Hussein. No, you compare. He says, number one, I'm not going to do your majlis once a day. That's it. No, twice. One in the morning, one in the evening. And as everybody cries you, with the tears, I said, no, I'm gonna go even two steps forward to cry you blood instead of tears. Because the crime that was committed on the day of Ashura is not a crime that nobody can even stand. That is the crime of Bani Umayyah. That is how great this tragedy is. Now, that is Imam al-Hujjah. Now, when you go to the hadith, we have so many ahadith. From the imams, they were saying la'an to so many people. But you know, even Imam al-Hujjah, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif, he has...
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
He has some sayings that he also cursed certain people. And they have nothing to do with the Imam Hussein. Just people, individual. What did he say? He said, la'natullah ala man istahalla min haqqina shay. May Allah send the punishment on any person who took our right and made it halal for himself. What does he mean? Here this is, he's talking about khums. If a person who khums is due on their money or their property and they fail to pay it, they took it as halal for themselves, Imam al-Hujjah said, la'anatullah ala man istahalla min haqqina. which is haram on us, on them, they made it halal for themselves. He said, may Allah curse the person. This is Imam al-Hujjah alayhi salam. Right? So if an imam, he would say la'na on the person who failed to pay his dues in Islam. Now what about a person who kills the grandson of the Prophet? If this person who didn't give the right of Ahlul Bayt, which is just money, now what about a person who took the life of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam? That is why it's very important to understand. Al-La'an is not just Allah says it, even the Rasulullah and Ahlul Bayt, all of that. So when you read Ziyarat Ashoura, we have to understand that yes, it's from Imam al-Ma'soom, and there is a base in that. Now, the last thing I want to mention also is that in Islam, we have to understand Islam as a general. In Islam, there is something we call At-Tawalli and Tabarri. Which means, I cannot say I'm a Muslim, but I love the enemies of Allah. Can a person be a Muslim while he loves Allah and he loves Shaitan at the same time? Can a person be a Muslim and say, I love Rasulullah and I love Abu Jahl at the same time? Can he be a Muslim at the same time? Can a person say, I love Allah, I love Rasulullah, and I love their enemies at the same time? No, you can't be a Muslim. Because in Islam is what? At-Tawalli and Tabarri. Which means, you have to, if you love Allah, anybody who is an enemy of Allah, you have to denounce them. If you love Rasulullah, anybody who is the enemy of Rasulullah, you have to denounce them. Because you cannot love Allah and love their enemies at the same time. That is why in Ziyarah we said, Inni silmun liman salamakum. Wa harbun liman harbun. You know, I'm at war with anybody who declare war at Ahlul Bayt. I'm at peace with whom are peace with you. Right? Now anybody, Allah, even in Hadith al-Kisa, Rasulullah, what did he say? Allahumma inni muhabbahum. Faj'al salawatuka wa barakatuka wa maghfiratuka wa rahmatuka wa ridwanuka alayya wa alayha wa adhib anhum al-rijsa wa tahhirhum tathhirhum. There is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day that the ayat al-tathhir was revealed. So now, a person cannot be a true Muslim or muwali li Ahlul Bayt and love the enemies of Ahlul Bayt at the same time. And this, when you go to Tafsir al-Zamakhshari, Zamakhshari also said in one hadith that he quoted from the Prophet, he says, Ala wa man mata ala bughdi ali Muhammad lam yashum ra'iha. Ala wa man mata ala bughdi ali Muhammad jaa yawm al-qiyamah maktubun ala jabhatihi ayisun min rahmatillah. That is Zamakhshari, one of the great Sunni scholars. He wrote a tafsir called Tafsir al-Kashaf. In that tafsir, he mentioned this hadith from the Prophet. That anyone who comes yawm al-qiyamah and he or she carries a hate towards Ahlul Bayt alayhi wassalam, he says, the Prophet says, Ala waman mata ala bughdi ali Muhammad lam yashum raihat al-jannah. The person will not even smell the heaven. The person will come yawm al-qiyamah, it's written on their forehead, and hopeless from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why not? When a person comes and looks at the tragedy of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, and he sees these people have committed a crime in such a way that no one of Imam Hussein's companions were left. His families, his companions, including infants, they all went through this tragedy. His own brother, Abu al-Fadl Abbas, who was also one of the martyrs, Shuhada of Karbala, that on the day of Ashura, 3 times he came and asked his brother permission. The first time he came, when he saw there is a need of water in the camp, and nobody will be able to go and get the water for the children. Abu al-Fadl Abbas, he went to his master, his brother, Imam Hussein, and asked him for the permission. Imam Hussein said, no, Ya Abu al-Fadl, you are the carrier of my banner and the flag carrier. He said, I cannot let you go if you get killed. He said, that was like my backbone in this group.
Then later on, Abu al-Fadl Abbas heard the children were crying. Al-Atash, Al-Atash. He then came for the second time. He said, "Oh my master, can you please allow me to go and take and get some water for those children? I can hear them. They crying. Al-Atash, Al-Atash." Imam Hussein said to him, "No, Ya Abu al-Fadl, wait. Please, don't go in." Time passes by, and then now a special request comes from Sukaina to Abu al-Fadl Abbas. "Ya Abbas, Al-Atash, I'm thirsty, I want water." That is when Imam Abu al-Fadl Abbas could not control it anymore. Now there is a specific request coming from the children. They want water. Now he went to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. He says, "Ya Abu Abdullah, Ya Sayyidi wa Mawlana." Now there is a special request from Sukaina. She wants water. "Can I go get her water?" Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he then granted the permission to Abu al-Fadl Abbas. "Go get them water." Abu al-Fadl Abbas got himself ready. And you know, Abu al-Fadl Abbas was a very tall man. He sat on his horse with his sword. He took his way towards the river. And there were 4,000 men just on the river. But Abu al-Fadl Abbas, he fought all of them. And was able to get to the river. And he was thirsty as well. He took the water to drink. He remembered his master. Allahu Akbar. He dropped the water. He said, "Ya nafsuhuni min ba'd al-Husayn." Allahu Akbar. He said, "This nafs, I love myself, I'm thirsty. But you know what? The love that I have for Hussein is much more than the love I have for myself. How can I drink and be happy with this water while my master is still waiting thirsty?" Allahu Akbar. He dropped the water. He filled the jar with the water. He got back on his horse. He took his way coming back to the tent to make sure that the water has got to those children, especially Sukaina alayhi salam. On his way, the enemies surrounded Abu al-Fadl Abbas. And you know, Umar bin Sa'd al-La'in, he said to those enemies, "Do not let Abbas get this water to the tent. Because if he does, he said, and the water gets to Hussein, he said, we will not be able to defeat Hussein. Look at these weak people, weak men. They're using water as a way to defeat Hussein alayhi salam." Abu al-Fadl Abbas took his way. He kept fighting those enemies one by one. And anybody who comes on the way of Abu al-Fadl Abbas, Abu al-Fadl Abbas, he ended up killing the person. And he continued moving forward. As he got closer to the tent of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, the narration says one of the enemies came hiding behind the palm tree with his sword. All he wanted is to strike the right arm of Abu al-Fadl Abbas. He came while Abu al-Fadl Abbas was busy fighting those who were in front of him. This man came from behind and he struck the right arm of Abu al-Fadl Abbas. Abu al-Fadl Abbas was managing. He managed to grab the water with the left arm, but he lost the right arm. And he said, "Wallahi in qata'tumu yamini, fa inni uhami abadan an dini. Wa an imam sadiq al yaqini." He said, "Wallah, if you cut my right arm," he said, "I want you to bear witness that I'm defending the true imam. I'm defending my religion, the right religion." Abu al-Fadl Abbas never gave up. He kept continuing his journey. Another man came behind and struck the left arm of Abu al-Fadl Abbas. The arm fell on the ground. Now Abu al-Fadl Abbas, no right arm to fight, no left arm to keep the water. The narration said, but Abu al-Fadl Abbas, as brave as he was, as strong as he was, because he carried the blood of Amir al-Mu'mineen, he was managed to hold the water with his mouth. Allahu Akbar. The narration said, one of them looked at that jar and he threw the spear towards that water. And the water spilled. Now Abu al-Fadl Abbas is on his horse. No water to take to those children. No arms to defend himself. Another sword came, struck the chest of Abu al-Fadl Abbas. He lost his balance, he fell on the ground. But while he was falling, he called his master Hussein, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. May the peace be upon you, oh my master Hussein. Then he fell on the ground. When he fell on the ground, Imam Hussein had that call. And anybody who calls Imam Hussein of all those companions and the families, anybody who calls him, Imam Hussein rushed to their aid. He rushed to Abu al-Fadl Abbas. Abu al-Fadl Abbas was covered with blood. He was covered with sand. Abu al-Fadl Abbas couldn't see. When Imam Hussein lifted him, he thought it was one of the enemies who came to cut his hair. He then said with a thin voice, Ya hada, ya hada, aqsimu alayka biman ta'bud illa ma amalta hatta ya'ti sayyidi wa imami al-Husayn. Allahu Akbar. He said, whoever you are, I ask you for the sake of whomever you worship, whomever you believe in. I said, don't kill me, don't cut my head until I got an opportunity to say goodbye to my master Hussein. You know, that was one thing that Imam Hussein could not control. Imam Hussein busted into tears. And he responded to Abu al-Fadl Abbas. He said, Ana akhuka al-Hussein, ya Abu al-Fadl. He said, it's your brother who lifted you. It's your brother who came to sympathize with your situation and comfort you in your last days, on the last moment. Abu al-Fadl Abbas, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, took his head and put on his thigh to comfort him and wipe those blood and the sand on his face. But Abu al-Fadl Abbas didn't want none of that because he was thinking the future of Imam Hussein himself. He then put his head on the floor, and then Imam Hussein, once again, he lifted the head of Abu al-Fadl Abbas. And he put it on his thigh to comfort him, but Abu al-Fadl Abbas would not let his head to stay on the thigh of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. After the third time, Imam Hussein asked him, Ya Abu al-Fadl, why don't you allow me to hold your head and comfort you in this difficult moment of yours, Ya Abu al-Fadl? Then he responded to his master, he says, Ya Sayyidi, I have you now to comfort me. A few minutes later when you get killed, who will be there to comfort you, Ya Hussein? Allahu Akbar. Look at the brother thinking about the future of his brother. Look at Abu al-Fadl Abbas thinking the future of his master Hussein alayhi salam. Then Abu al-Fadl Abbas busted into tears, and Imam Hussein busted into tears as well. They started crying for one another, and then Imam Hussein was looking at his face, comforting him, and then wiping the blood on him, trying to say goodbye to him. In that last moment, Abu al-Fadl Abbas was looking at his brother. Then Imam Hussein said to him, let me take you to the tent as I do with all the martyrs. Then Abu al-Fadl Abbas said no to his brother. He said, no, Ya Hussein, I don't want to go to that tent. Imam Hussein asked him, why, Ya Abu al-Fadl? That is my custom with all the shuhada. Anybody who got struck or killed, or anybody who get injured, I always take him to the tent, at least to help him. He said, no, because of one reason, Ya Hussein. What is it? I said, because I promised Sukaina water, and I know she's waiting for that water, and I was not able to get him that water. Allahu Akbar. Now, if you are a father or a mother, and your son or your daughter, who always expecting you to take care of their needs, and they're looking up to you to fulfill your promise towards them, and they are looking for something desperate, and then you promise them, I'll bring it to you. And then the day comes and you are in a situation where you will not
be able to provide it for them. How would you feel? Abul Fadl Abbas said, I don't want to go to the tent because I don't want to see Sukaina with me in this situation, and I have no water for her after I promised her. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he looked at his brother Abul Fadl Abbas in that last moment. Abul Fadl Abbas then has last breath and left from this world. And Imam Hussein alayhi salam was watching, and then he left his brother at that place according to his will. Imam Hussein left him. The narration said, Imam Hussein came back to the tent, and then Sukaina met him. She says, Ya Abati, Aina al-Abbas? Oh, my father, Ya Abi, where is Abbas? He promised me water. Imam Hussein said, Kutila Abbas. Abbas was killed. And then Imam Hussein said, Al-ana kasara dhahri wa shamta bi adwi. He said, now my backbone has been broken. Abul Fadl Abbas was the one that I depend on. Now he's gone. Now my army is gone. And now my enemies will get the opportunity to laugh at me. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. إلهنا نسألك وندعوك بأحب الخلق إليك بمحمد وآله وفاطمة والحسن والحسين والتسعة المعصومين من ذرية الحسين. اللهم بحقهم عليك فرج عنا فرجا عاجلا قريبا كلمح البصر أو هو أقرب من ذلك. اللهم بحقهم عليك شاف جميع مرضى المسلمين يا الله. اللهم بحقهم عليك وبحقك عليهم أقض حوائج المؤمنين والمؤمنات يا الله. اللهم بحقهم عليك وبحقك عليهم يا الله. فرج عنا فرجا عاجلا قريبا كلمح البصر أو هو أقرب من ذلك. For the distress of those brothers and sisters, especially those who are sick, let's recite Amma Yujib for the fastest recovery of the brother, especially this community. Those we have as a sick sister and a brother, they both are in hospital. May Allah give them the fastest recovery. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Amma Yujibul Muttarra Idha Da'a Wa Yashifu As-Su'a. Amma Yujibul Muttarra Idha Da'a Wa Yashifu As-Su'a. أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء. أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء. أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء. بسمك العظيم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله. 10 times. Ya Allah, 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 إلى أمواتكم وأموات المؤمنين والمؤمنات. لا سيما الجالسين الحاضرين في المجلس. رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة مع الصلوات.